so glad to be here. Thank you so much. So I got started at Salesforce earlier this year. Before that, I was a student at UT Austin, finishing up my PhD. And beginning of the year, I had this problem that I was facing is, how can we have this sense of explainability in language models, or like, you know, just like any NLP model? Because I feel like it's easier to do explainable AI on vision because you are restricted to this 224 by 224 size pixel area. So it's like, you know, all the saliency maps, all the explanations can be very much restricted in that. But language, as we all know, is like the vocabulary is huge, it's exploding, and so it's much more difficult to have models that can explain on text. So that was my motivation, and I started off at Salesforce earlier this year. And so I just wanted to give you a little bit of background before we get started. And so this is a XKCD very well-known comic, and the idea here is that like our community, the deep learning, machine learning community, has been focusing so much on the state of the art and like getting that performance, like, you know, getting to the human accuracy and so on, that we sometimes forget that what are the kind of the implications of having this model. Like, what are the ethical implications? Are there biases in my data set? Like, are there biases in my model? And am I looking into that, or am I overlooking it? Or even worse, like, we know that there are biases, but because we get good performance, we just deploy them. So I think the idea of explainable AI is to, like, we see that is our model latching on to these wrong assumptions, or like what kind of features this model is latching onto, and are we okay with that? So I feel like explainability is very fundamental to any intelligence. If, like us as humans, like we do reasoning all the time. Even like for AI models, there is reasoning. It might be more implicit, but the idea behind XAI is to make this reasoning more explicit so that we as humans should know what's going behind the scene, and like we can have this trusted relationship with AI models. So earlier this year, like when I started off in this work, we wrote this paper which got published at ACL, which is again a top conference in NLP, and the work is basically leveraging language models for common sense reasoning. The idea behind that is that when we want these NLP models to have explainability, we want them to have common sense, just like people, because we, like living in this world, know some things, like how they work, and then we would also expect the AI model to have this common sense reasoning so that we can interact with it more seamlessly and we can have this more trusted relationship, because then they would understand us more better. So let's get started with this work. So common sense reasoning. What if I ask you what would happen if someone pushes a glass off the table? You'd probably say, it will fall down, reasonable. And then if I ask you why, you might say, gravity. And that's so obvious to us, right? Like, we live in this world, we know how the world works, and that's something we call common sense. But guess what? Neural networks don't have that. They don't live in this world just like us humans, and so they cannot understand these things that we call common sense or how the world works. In fact, they are so bad at this common sense reasoning that they are. The recent research shows that they are approximately 30 accuracy points behind humans. And as we know, deep learning came around, like the era of deep learning, and it's been crushing numbers. We are at like human accuracy at most of these tasks, or like some tasks that we call, like, you know, are these benchmarks that we view them as. But when these data sets came out with this common sense reasoning, we found that they are far lagging behind human accuracy. So this is what I started by investigating. There have been tons of data sets that came out that, you know, kind of like pose this problem of common sense reasoning in neural networks. And here are some of them. One of them is this, the SWAG data set. Here you have like this partial description of what's happening in a scene, and the task is to predict what's going to happen in the next scene. And so imagine this is like, you know, an event in a video or a movie, and then the right answer would be what's going to happen in the event in the next frame or the next event in the movie and so on. So another data set is this common sense question answering data set, in which you have a question, and that's all the context you have. And then you have these five choices, and you have to select what the right choice is. And the third one is visual common sense reasoning. In this, you have an image along with a question, a natural language question. The image has certain objects identified as being important, and the question is about something about like doing common sense reasoning on the image, and that involves these identified objects. And finally, the fourth one is the story closed data set. In this, you have a small snippet or story, and then you have a correct ending and an incorrect ending. And the task is to predict which ending should be the right ending for the story. So in this paper, we focused on this problem of common sense reasoning, and we focused on this data set because it was one of the more difficult data sets, given that it does not have any context and it's only natural language. And so this data set is called Common Sense QA. It came out earlier this year. So the problem statement that we look at is, how can we incorporate common sense reasoning in neural networks? And for, in particular, like I broke down this question into a bunch of smaller, more sort of tangible questions. And one of them was, can neural networks use human common sense explanations? So I started off by collecting a bunch of human explanations. So I took some of the instances from this Common Sense QA data set, and I gave it to humans, and I asked them, why do you think this is the appropriate answer to the question? For example, if you have a question, where are trees safest? And there are some options. The options in this case are universities, state park, or Toronto. And the right answer is state park, and so I give that right answer as well. And I ask the human, can you justify why this is the right answer? And there are two subtasks in it. The number one is to highlight what words in the question were, like justify the correct answer. And second thing is write a natural language explanation for why you think that is the correct answer. So in this case, safest is the key word in the question, and that kind of goes as the justification for why state park is the right answer. And the natural language open-ended explanation for, again, this question is state parks have rules to keep trees protected, and that is just an example of what a human gave as an explanation for why state park is the right answer. So when I collected a bunch of these, I started looking and analyzing what these human explanations were talking about. And I found that they captured world knowledge. These are things that we as humans just know, like, you know, just by living in the world, doing our everyday things. And so in particular, I kind of like bucketed them into these certain types. And some of the types are on the slide over here. The first one is cause and effects. So there were some explanations related to cause and effects, such as disagreements lead to fights. And then there were social norms, such as like, you know, we humans eat 3 meals a day, or like, you know, forgiving activates good karma. And these are things that, again, you know, world knowledge, right? And then there were laws of physics, obviously, because like, you know, gravity makes things fall, and, you know, like different types of laws of physics, like collision, friction, those were kind of like the words that came up in the explanation as well. And then there was geography, like, you know, some things that we know is obvious, like United States is a country, Minnesota is a state, and so on. And then there were other category, like a category, like, you know, if it did not fall in any of these, I put them in another category. And then example of this was just the example I gave you earlier, that state parks have rules to keep trees protected. So as you can see, I also did like some of the statistical analysis of what these human explanations were, like the natural language human explanation had in them. And in particular, 30% of them had the actual answer. So this means that the humans were actually taking the right answer and using that to explain why that is the right answer. So like the example of the state park is the right answer, and then the human says state parks have rules to keep trees protected. So he used the actual answer in the explanation. And then I also saw that 35% of them had the distractor words. So the distractor words are the ones that are the incorrect choices. So in that case would be universities and Toronto. So some people would find it hard to basically justify by using the correct answer. So they would say, oh, it definitely cannot be this and this, so it has to be that. Like, you know, basically eliminating the incorrect choices. And 58.5% of them had at least an answer or distractor. So this says that even though a majority of them were trying to justify using the actual answer choices, there were many explanations that did not have any answer choices or words in them. So they were just justifying by some, like, you know, using their own knowledge or using, like, you know, describing things that are related to maybe the question or the answer choices, but not using the exact answer choices themselves. So now going back to our question of, can neural networks use human common sense explanation? So what I did is, I took this human common sense explanations along with the original question and answer and trained a neural network model on it. And so this is the exact number of instances that I used for collecting the actual human explanations, and I trained it on just this many explanations. And I found that just by training on human explanations, at test time there was no human explanation because I did not even know what the right answer is, so let alone actually collecting explanations on those questions, right? So I just trained it, and I found that it was still like beating the state of the art by 6%. And that's incredible, right? Because when initially we were looking at these models and they were performing really poorly on the common sense reasoning data set, and now suddenly just by giving it like these few thousand human explanation, and only during training I was able to improve the state of the art by 6%. So we exactly don't know what was going on, but the intuition is that maybe it was able to find these correlations or words that it saw during the saw in the explanation and the question, and it can find correlations between them, and so it remembers that, and during tests it also uses that to make better predictions. And so the human common sense explanation we found was very useful for us. And so we kind of processed it, made it in this nice format, and we have publicly released it on this GitHub, on the Salesforce GitHub. It's called COSY, the common sense explanation. And here is a QR code if you want to directly go to that GitHub page. So the second question that we look at is, can neural networks generate their own common sense reasoning? Now that we know that they can use the human explanations, what if they can generate their own? Maybe they can use it as well during tests, right? Because if it's their own, you're not cheating, you're not asking a human what the right answer or the right explanation is. So what we did is we fine-tuned a large language model on a small number of human explanations. So to those who don't know what a language model is, think of it as a model that that predicts the distribution over a sequence of words. So it basically predicts what is the most likely next word given the current sequence of words. So that is the definition of what a language model looks like. We have a ton of really huge language models, the Transformers, the BERT, the GPT. These are really well-known language models that are there out there. So we just used one of those. These language models are pre-trained on a lot of text already. So imagine that they are trained on entire Wikipedia, several hundred books, and so basically they have seen a lot of training data, and then so we just fine-tune it on a very small number of human common sense explanation, and this is how we do it. So for a language model, you can give it a prompt, basically the sequence of words that I was talking about, and then it would complete that by predicting what the most likely next sequence of words should be. So in this case, we take the question, which was the original question, this is the training step. So you take the question, the choices, and we give it something like my common sense tells me, and then we let it complete what the language model thinks is the most likely sequence of words. And then we want it to predict words which are very similar to what a human generated. So there's a human generated explanation, which is sort of like the gold standard that we consider as gold standard. And so we want the language model to predict that. And in the first few iterations, we saw that the generated explanation was really bad. It was not even grammatical. It had many repetitive words, and it looked really bad. But then after a few iterations, we found that it kind of converged to something which looked a lot like a human wrote it. And so we were oh, wow, this is amazing. It can almost produce explanations similar to what a human would write. So this is what the training step, once we think that, it has converged, the blue score is something satisfactory to what a human would have produced, we stop the training, and now we know that this model has seen sufficiently human common sense explanations. So then how do we make this model generate new explanations? We just take this model and give it a new prompt, instances that it has never seen before, and let it complete it on this new instances. So for example, what might help if my dog wants a drink but his bowl is empty? The choices are cabinet, cup, or can. And my common sense tells me, and I let the language model complete it. And we got something like, a cup is the only thing that can help a dog. This seems like not something a person would write, but it seems like it looks really good. It's very grammatical. It's very, like, basically it has the answer in it. And it seems something that is incredible, right? Like a language model produced it. So now that we know, we answered that question, yes, language models can produce their own common sense explanations. The next question we look at is, can neural networks use these auto-generated reasoning? And so for this, what we did is we had this set up like this. So now this is the inference or the test of the common sense on the common sense QA data set. So in the first step, you have the prompt. You have the language model take the instance and generate an explanation. In the next step, you have the classifier that takes in the original question, the answer choices, and the generated explanation, and then makes the prediction. So in this case, it takes the generated explanation that the language model produced and predicts the right answer, which is the cup. So for this, I'm going to just go a little bit in technical details about what the language model was and what the classifier in this case was. So we used a pre-trained GPT, which is OpenAI's model. And when we were like working on this, it was just GPT-1. So although it seems like just like beginning of year, it feels like there were so many more models released after that. So this was GPT-1 as the language model for a cage is the common sense auto-generated explanation. And then for language model prompt, we used something like the question, the three choices, and my common sense tells me, I already went over this, but just want to put it on the slide again. And then we used the BERT model for classification. Again, BERT is a language model. It's a transformer language model. It has a slightly different structure than GPT, but just imagine like a very big language model that has seen a lot of data. And for that, the BERT has these classification heads. And so we use the classification head of BERT. And so it takes in the question, and it takes in the explanation and the choices. And then it makes the prediction on what the right choice should be. So here are what the results look like on the Common Sense QA data set. So I think you might like wonder that, OK, you are generating these explanations. That's extra data. Big deal, you will obviously get better results, right? Like extra data is always better. It helps you in like learning more and training more. And so what's the big deal that you are like getting 6% or 10% more than the state of the art? But guess what? The original paper for Common Sense QA did a similar thing. What they did is they took a reading comprehension model. So the RC model is the reading comprehension model. They took the question and an answer choice and Google searched it. And they took the first 100 snippets that came out of it. That's like almost like cheating, right? Like they are getting the question and the answer and they're like Googling it and getting whatever out of it and giving it to their model. And then they did it for every answer choice. So if you have three choices, there'll be 300 snippets. And then they trained it using a very popular reading comprehension model. And they found that that actually affects their accuracy. Their performance actually goes down. So always like more data is not always good. And that is, here is an example of that. And then they had the state-of-the-art model in their paper, which was the OpenAI GPT model that we used for as a language model as well. And they found that that performed really well on just like directly classification. And then is the model that is our model that just takes human explanations during training, but at test time, it only takes the question and answer choices. And as I said, that it was 6% more than the state of the art in the paper, which was the GPT model. And then finally, we have the auto-generated explanation model, which is our state-of-the-art model. And what this does is it generates its own explanation and then uses it to make a prediction. And so the BERT is the classifier, the GPT is the language model in that case. And so these two are the models that we proposed. And guess what? Even though we are like beating the state of the art and we are like, you know, 10% above the state of the art in the paper, the human accuracy is still at 95.3. That's amazing. Like there's like still such a big gap over there, right? And so some of you, if you have questions about, like, did you try just, like, running BERT, because BERT is, like, known to, like, crush all these benchmarks. Yes, we did it on a dev set because we had some restrictions on doing it on test set because you have to submit it to the leaderboard and you can only do it so many number of times. So we did it on the dev set, and we found that both of our models were beating just the BERT, using BERT for classification on this data set. And so this is kind of like just an overview on another example of how our model works. So it takes in a prompt, the language model generates it. In the next step, the BERT classifier takes in the question and the answer choices, and then the auto-generated explanation and predicts what the right answer is going to be. So this is the exact pipeline of how it works. So we did some error analysis as to, like, oh, like, you know, this looks reasonable, the explanations look reasonable, but why is still there? Why is there such a big gap still between human accuracy and what our model is getting? And we saw that a lot of the times, the explanations are actually really good, but the classifier just chooses to ignore them. For example, if you have a question, what is the main purpose of having a bath? And the bold is something that is the ground truth answer that, you know, that we are kind of like scored against. And the underlined is what our model predicted. So if you see the explanation generated by our model is the only purpose of having a bath is to clean yourself. And that's kind of what the actual answer is. But the classifier takes in the explanation and predicts hygiene instead of like cleanness or something related to clean, right? And similarly, in this thing, in the second instance, it's exactly the explanation has the exact answer word in it, but still the classifier chooses to ignore that when it takes the explanation along with the question and still predicts something else. And even in the third one, I feel like a lot of these, like, for example, the third one, it's even, like, difficult for a human to basically say what is the right answer. There are, like, so many choices, and each of them, like, some of them look very similar to each other, and there's, like, the difference is very subtle. So the final thing we look at is, okay, now that we have this neural network that generates common sense reasoning, can we transfer it to other tasks? Like we are doing this on this common sense QA data set, but there's so many other tasks that claim to be doing common sense reasoning. Can we transfer it? And so what we did is, we just took our language model that was fine-tuned on a bunch of common sense QA explanations, and then we generated on a new domain. So we go from common sense QA to this SWAG data set, which is basically predicting what the next sequence or the likely event is given the current partial description. So we found that the BERT model by itself has a really good performance on, like, almost human performance on the SWAG data set. When we add the explanations to it, we found that the performance is slightly affected. The performance goes down slightly, and so it comes at the cost of this explainability. But then again, we did some error analysis, and although this is cherry-picked, we found that a lot of these answers or the explanations that were generated by a model looked really incredible, and they're like, wow. So remember that this data set is something that this model has never seen. It's completely, it's like a zero-shot transfer to a completely new data set. It has only seen, like, the common sense question answering explanation. And so, for example, a question like, the man examines the instrument in his hand, and you have to predict what's going to happen in the next scene. And the right answer is, the person holds up the violin to his chin and gets ready. And the explanation generated by our model is, the person is holding the instrument in his hand. That's very close to what the actual thing is. And so it looks really incredible that, you know, even with the zero-shot transfer, it does so well. So I just wanted to, like, go over summarize what we learned today. The first one of them is that human explanations used only during training improves performance. So human explanation is really good, and, like, we could use that even though we were only using it during training. We found that our model was able to, like, learn a lot of these common sense reasoning or world knowledge just from a handful of human explanations. And we found that explanations were a way to incorporate common sense reasoning in neural networks, because as the research has shown, that it's very difficult to incorporate common sense reasoning or world knowledge in neural networks. And I think explanation is one way to achieve that. And language models these days are powerful enough to generate meaningful common sense explanations. Language models have gotten really big. They have become incredible. They can generate a lot of good, like, so if you can use it in a good way, like, such as for, you know, like, leveraging this this property of explainability, you can get really meaningful explanations out of them. And we found that the auto-generated explanations improved accuracy by 10% on this Common Sense QA data set. Okay, and now, more recently, I've been working on this benchmark called the Eraser. So let me tell you that there is no benchmark for interpretability in NLP. So we don't know what are good data sets. There are no good data sets, there are no good models, and even worse, there are no good evaluation of metrics. Like, if I generate explanation, like, what is the gold standard? What is the right explanation? There's, like, no such kind of, like, benchmark that kind of unifies all these models, metrics, and data sets. And so, my work at Salesforce, along with collaboration with folks at Northeastern, we released this benchmark very recently called the Eraser benchmark as a first ever benchmark for interpretability in NLP. And finally, here are some of the media outlets that covered my work and some news coverage about this specific work on common sense reasoning. And thank you. And I just wanted to iterate that I'm hiring research scientists in explainable AI. So if you're interested, please come talk to me. Thank you so much.
So given the fact that human reasoning is fallible, and it's spectacularly so, you are using human reasoning as both training method and validation method. Do you find that problematic? And then if you, the second part of the question, if you like, if you insist on using human reasoning, the prior art in your paper doesn't, give fairness to human reasoning that you can actually date back to ancient Greece, and Aristotle started off, well, at least what we know, started off around reasoning. So don't you think that formal logic would be a good start with reasoning? Thank you.
Oh, that's because, okay, so the thing is, like, I feel like we as humans can adapt very easily to things in our environment, and AI models are very brittle and they cannot. So for example, if you're walking on a road and you find that something is slippery, you know that you have to be careful and walk slowly, and you can adapt to that. But AI models cannot do that. Specifically, even like reinforcement learning agents, they are trained and tested on the exact same environment. Because guess what? If you make small changes or perturbations to their environment, they're going to fail in a spectacular manner. They cannot adapt to these things. And we feel that we can kind of like leverage these things of adaptability and generalization from humans by kind of instilling these things of reasoning into neural networks.
Nasreen, thank you for the talk. It was great. I have a couple of questions. When you talked about capturing world knowledge in the first question that you asked, what is the tool that you used for capturing knowledge, and how the human explanation are supplied into the system for the first use case that you talked about?
So you're asking how, what is the tool I use? I use Mechanical Turk. So we had like some restrictions on like, you know, what regions people belong to and things like that. I mean, what we kind of like had these like, you know, what do you call it? Like, you know, some examples in there which we feel that humans should do it correctly for in order to qualify to be like, I think it's called the honeypot or something, where you put these examples in there and you make sure that people do that correctly or like something that is very similar to what you have as the ground truth. And then you can like, you know, use their work on these other instances to be used as like human explanations.
My second part is how the human explanations are supplied into the model.
Oh, so that we just use it as like very similar to what I showed for the BERT model. And so in the BERT model, you have this CLS token, and then you have the question, then you have the SEP token, and then you give the explanation, and then you have a SEP token again and the choice, and then you do that only during training. So at test time, it's only CLS, question, SEP, and choice. It doesn't have that explanation. Yes.
Okay, hi. So my question is with regards to the question of can the neural networks auto-generate common sense explanations. Isn't the language model that's been developed really similar to the Chinese room problem? Because what it did was essentially find the correlation between the words, the cup and the drink, and then it sort of formulated that in an English sentence similar to the text that it has seen before. Mm-hmm. And in light of the answer to that question, how do you see applications of that model evolving?
Sorry, what was the question?
In light of the answer of was this really a Chinese room problem versus actual common sense reasoning? And in light of the answer to that question, what would be applications for that language model in real life that you see happening in the future?
Oh, so like you're asking like what would the applications of language model in general be on the work of like common sense reasoning? Oh, I feel I think explainability, there is no doubt that we would need explainability for wide adoption of AI, specifically in these crucial applications like, you know, autonomous cars and healthcare. And I feel like common sense reasoning is kind of more fundamental to that, because like suppose that I have Alexa or like my assistant or someone, and I tell them, can you put me down for dinner with XYZ or someone, right? So it would make sense that if Alexa knows that I'm already going for dinner with someone today, to not put me down for two dinners in a row for the same day, but instead put it on some other day. So like, there are these like things that, you know, if I would tell you as a human, you would know that, yeah, obviously you're not gonna have two dinners in a day, or you wouldn't like things that we think are like, you know, common sense or everyday knowledge, but that like is not obvious to these, you know, kind of like these AI models that work with us, such as these voice assistants, and then even in like autonomous cars and like all these other places. Like, I feel like common sense reasoning is very, very kind of fundamental to being able to like explain what the model is doing. And so that's what I see the future as.